Dear students, welcome to this video on a short lecture on Give Us a Role Model. Now, who is a role model? In short, a role model can be somebody who is an inspiration to us to achieve something. Now, it is very inevitable that a role model need not be just one person. In the course of life, a person could have many role models as much as they want. What do I mean by that is, if you have different fields of passion at the same time and hobbies at the same time and favorite pastimes at the same time, now the field could have a different role model, the hobby you pursue can have a different role model, and the pastime you have also can have a different role model. So it is not necessary that a person should lead by example of one person in his or her life alone. So the question here is, give us a role model. Now, who is this question being addressed to? Of course, the question is being addressed to Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. Now, APJ Abdul Kalam has took India by surprise by coming from a very socially low economic status family from a southern Indian town called Rameshwaram. He studied in St. Joseph College. He went on to serve in the ISRO, and he was also part of DRDO. So you could see that how Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam himself has inspired a lot of students all across India. Not to forget, he is one of the most popular presidents of India that India has seen in its history. Now, that is one of the reasons why we have this lesson in our own syllabus. Give us a role model is a take from the point of view of Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, who goes on to talk about how school students who ask a lot of questions to him have in one way or the other become his role model. So it is a very not very obvious kind of a text where you don't find Abdul Kalam giving us who can be his role model, but then he finds that the school students he has met in many years, especially to during his presidency, almost he has visited 40,000 high school students, and we could consider that all of these students he had met could be his role model because of the inspiration they give. So let us move ahead and then find out how these students inspire Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. It only means that even at his age, Abdul Kalam was willing to learn from somebody who is very young in age. Please look at the first paragraph. He says, why should I meet young students in particular? Seeking the answer, I went back to my student days. From the island of Rameshwaram, what a great journey it's been. Looking back, it all seems quite incredible. What was it that made possible? Hard work, ambition, many things come to my mind. I feel the most important thing was that I always assessed my worth by the value of my contribution. The fundamental thing is that you must know that you deserve the good things of life, the benefits that God bestows. Unless our students and young believe that they are worthy of being citizens of a developed India, how will they ever be responsible and enlightened citizens? So in the beginning paragraph, you find that APJ Abdul Kalam is asking the question, why should he meet young students from all over India? But he compares himself to a student, or he is asking a question, how did a student, a young boy from island of Rameshwaram took a great journey and became the president of India? Is it his hard work? Is it his ambition? But then he feels that it is the value system that has governed his life. Especially APJ Abdul Kalam feels that he has always considered himself to be worthy enough, which is one of the value system he has grown up with. In the same manner, he asks that the young students of India, young people of India, should believe that they should be worthy enough to live in a country like or a developed country like India? Or in other words, they deserve to live in developed India, meaning they could make the country a developed nation. That is exactly the point APJ Abdul Kalam is trying to make in the first paragraph. Let me continue with the next paragraph. There is nothing mysterious about the abundance in developed nations. The historic fact is that the people of these nations, the G8 as they are called, believed over many generations that they must live a good life in a strong and prosperous nation. The reality became aligned with their aspirations. I do not think that abundance and spirituality are mutually exclusive, or that it is wrong to desire material things. For instance, while I personally cherish a life with minimum of possessions, I admire abundance, for it brings along with it security and confidence. And these eventually help preserve our freedom. Nature, too, does not do anything by half measures, as you will see if you look around you. Now, both these paragraphs insist on a particular word called abundance. In short, Abdul Kalam believes that it is not that we shouldn't desire for material things. He makes a comparison to international group of nations called the G8, where he says that abundance of resources and materials promote the attitude of the people living there, who start to have aspirations for a better life. In short, Abdul Kalam means that abundance will give you these aspirations to live a better life. So if you want to live a better life, you search for these material things, and when you search for these material things, obviously you start to cherish life itself, and then you look for ways, better ways to attain this abundance. So this abundance, according to him, also gives you security and confidence to live a wonderful life. He makes a comparison to his own life, saying that he personally likes to live with minimum of possessions, but still he does not judge a person who wants desires material things. Moving on, go to a garden. In season, there is a profusion of flowers. Or look up, the universe stretches into infinitude, vast beyond belief. All that we see in the world is an embodiment of energy. We are a part of the cosmic energy too, as Sri Aurobindo says. Therefore, when we begin to appreciate the spirit and matter are both part of existence, are in harmony with each other, we shall realize that it is wrong to feel that it is somehow shameful or non-spiritual to desire material things. Yet this is what we are often led to believe. Certainly, there is nothing wrong with an attitude of making do with the minimum in leading a life of asceticism. Mahatma Gandhi led such a life, but in his case, as in yours, it has to be a matter of choice. You follow such a lifestyle because it answers a need that arises from deep within you. However, making a virtue of sacrifice and what is forced upon you to celebrate suffering is a different thing altogether. This was the basis of my decision to contact our young, to know their dreams and tell them it is perfectly all right to dream of a good life, an abundant life, a life full of pleasures and comforts, and work for that golden era. Whatever you do must come from the heart, express your spirit, and thereby you will also spread love and joy around you. So, to paraphrase what Abdul Kalam says in the last three paragraphs is that, spiritually, at least in the Indian context, we are made to believe that it is shameful or non-spiritual to desire material things. But APJ Abdul Kalam, in this particular text called Give Us a Role Model, says that it is okay, and there is nothing wrong with the attitude of, you know, trying to desire for material things. He says leading a life of asceticism is a deliberate choice, right? So when you have abundance, if you choose to live a life of asceticism, that is fine. But then when you do not have resources and then you are forced to live a life of suffering, that is a different thing altogether according to him. And this is one of the reasons why he decides, that is APJ Abdul Kalam decides to meet the students of our own India, the young students of India. So we have in the in page number 2, paragraph number 3, the answer to the question he starts with. Why should I meet the youngsters of India, which he asks in the first paragraph, and it is because of this reason. He thinks that, or he believes that, he should go to every other youngster in India and then tell them that, or understand their dream first of all, and then tell them that it is perfectly alright to dream of a good life. It is perfectly alright to dream of an abundant life, a life full of pleasure and comfort, and work for that golden era. So this is the reason, exact reason why APJ Abdul Kalam went around meeting at least 40,000 high school students all over India. Let me continue to read the rest of the paragraph, where you find him putting together the questions asked by many students, especially high school students, from the places he had visited throughout his presidency. Look at the first paragraph where he talks about his student visit. Please allow me to read. My first such meeting took place in a high school in Tripura. It was a gathering of 500 students and teachers. After my talk on the second vision for transforming India into a developed nation, there were a series of questions, two of which I would like to discuss. The first question was, where do we get a role model from? How do you get a role model? Whether we are aware of it or not, from childhood onwards, through various phases of life, we adopt role models. I said, when you are growing up, say till the age of 15, the best role model I can think of would be your father, your mother, and your school teacher. They, to my mind, are the people who can impart the best guidance during this period. I turned to the teachers and parents present there and told them what a big responsibility they have. I personally believe the full development of a child with the value system can only come from these people. In my own home, when I was growing up, I used to see my father and mother say namaz 5 times a day, and in spite of their modest financial resources, I found them always giving to the needy around. My teacher, Siva Subramani Iyer, was responsible for persuading my father to send me to school, setting aside financial constraints. It is very important for every parent to be willing to make the effort to guide children to be good human beings, enlightened and hardworking. The teacher, the child's window to learning and knowledge, has to play the role model in generating creativity in the child. This triangle is indeed the role model I can think of. I would even go to the extent of saying that if parents and teachers show the required dedication to shape the lives of young, India would get a new life. As it is said, behind the parents stands the school and behind the teacher, the home. Education and the teacher-student relationship have to be seen not in business terms but with the nation's growth in mind. A proper education would help nurture a sense of dignity and self-respect among our youth. These are qualities no law can enforce. They have to be nurtured ourselves. The children enjoyed this answer, though I don't know whether the parents and teachers got the message. So in this particular paragraph, you could find that a student directly asks how a role model can be chosen. Now you would find that APJ Abdul Kalam divides his answer into two parts, where first he talks about the golden triangle in any child's life. A child, in order to have a role model at least until the age of 15 years, has to look after this golden triangle called father, mother and teacher. Now it is from this place we have good value system. Now it is this place your father, mother, and teacher who imbibe enlightenment and hardworking values to make a child good human beings in the world. And this is one of the reasons why he thinks that father and mother, the value system that is nurtured at the home level, is very important. So he uses the example of his father and mother who say namaz 5 times a day, and in spite of their money problem or the poverty problem they have, they used to help others, especially when it comes to food. They help needy people around them. And APJ Abdul Kalam was not able to go to school because of the financial constraints of his own home. But APJ Abdul Kalam's teacher, Mr. Sivasubramanian Iyer, took it as his own responsibility to convince the father of APJ Abdul Kalam to make him come to school. So you could see that how the value system of APJ Abdul Kalam from his young age has started to come through his mother, his father, and his teacher. And finally, he means that teacher and education should have a good relationship, but never in a business term, because this is a relationship which would determine the growth of the nation. A proper education, not just in school but also at home, should nurture a sense of dignity and self-respect, according to APJ Abdul Kalam. So only at home and school the sense of dignity and self-respect could be nurtured, meaning your books, your notebooks, your materials you have cannot teach this, but then your teacher, your mother, your father can teach you sense of dignity and self-respect. So this is the point he tries to make. But then APJ Abdul Kalam is probably worried or thinking that whether the parents and the teachers got the message, in spite of the reason that children enjoyed the answer that he had given to the youngsters that they have gathered there. Let us look at the next paragraph. Another girl, in all seriousness, asked, "Every day we read in the newspaper or hear our parents talk about Atankavadis or terrorists. Who are they? Do they belong to our country?" This question really shocked me. I myself was searching for an answer. They are our own people. Sometimes we create them through political and economic isolation, or they can be fanatics, sometimes sponsored by hostile nations trying to disrupt normal life through terrorism. I looked at the audience, at the people sitting by my side, at the teachers, and at the sky for an answer. I said, "Children, I am reminded of our epics, the Ramayana and Mahabharata. In the Ramayana, the battle is between the divine hero Rama and demon king Ravana. It is a long drawn battle that finally Rama wins. In the Mahabharata, there is the battle at Kurukshetra. In this fight between good and evil, Dharma wins again. The battles are many, but finally peace triumphs. In our times too, we have seen this battle between good and evil, for instance, the Second World War. It seems to me that both good and evil survive side by side. The Almighty does help them both to various degrees. How to minimize the evil through our spiritual growth is a question that has persisted throughout human history." You could find that at least in this paragraph, APJ Abdul Kalam gets a shocking question from one of the young girls who says, "Who are these terrorists?" Sincerely and honestly, APJ Abdul Kalam himself cannot find an answer to this straightforward question, which he very honestly agrees in this text you could find here. But then he is remembered of how terrorists are created through our own making, our own, human beings, our own enemies, our own hostile nations, our own politics, our own economic conditions sometimes create terrorists, and there are many factors which contribute to the creation of a terrorist. But then he would like to reinstate to the people who ask this question that one way or the other, peace always triumphs, and he has understood this through the reading of Ramayana and Mahabharata. So finally, he mentions or gives a solution that good and evil exist side by side, but it is the personal spiritual growth of each person that would finally give birth to the minimalization of evil. Let us move ahead to the next paragraph. On another occasion, I addressed a very large gathering of students at St. Mary's School, Dindigul in Tamil Nadu, on their 75th anniversary celebrations. Among the large number of children wishing to meet me were two who were in a hurry to get an answer from me. One student asked, "I have read your book Agni Siragugal, the Tamil version of Wings of Fire. You always give a message to dream. Tell me, why dream?" My answer was to ask the gathered children to recite the following: dream, dream, dream. Dream transforms into thoughts, thoughts result in actions. I told them, "Friends, if there are no dreams, there are no revolutionary thoughts. If there are no thoughts, no actions will emanate. Hence, parents and teachers should allow their children to dream. Success always follows dreams attempted, though there may be some setbacks and delays." Now, this is a very popular question which any young student who is aware of APJ Abdul Kalam can understand really. It is him who has asked the students, young students of India, to dream. And we generally brush it away with the question, "I only dream when I am asleep, so I would like to go to sleep instead of studying." No, that is not exactly what APJ Abdul Kalam means when he asks the young students of India to dream. He also explains that in another text, especially Wings of Fire, that it is not the dream which you get in your sleep that he is talking about. It is the dream which does not allow us to sleep. Meaning, it is the dream which is an aspiration and we pursue it day and night without, sleep. So, in simple answer, he says that only when you start dreaming about a good life, for example, good life with a good house to live in, with a good, with abundance of wealth and resources, for example, car, right, with good kids and everything like that, only when you aspire to have this dream can be converted into thoughts. Now, the thoughts can be converted into action because you start to pursue this thought, and because of the reason that you had the dream, you are pursuing this thought. So, only when you dream, dreams convert themselves into thought and thoughts become action, only then your dream can be realized, which is exactly the answer APJ Abdul Kalam is trying to give the students of India. He also advises that sometimes there can be setbacks and delays, but then constant trying towards success will always result in getting those dreams fulfilled. So let me read the next paragraph. Another boy asked, "Please tell me who would be the first scientist in the world." It occurred to me, science was born and survives only by questions. The whole foundation of science is questioning. And as parents and teachers well know, children are the source of unending questions. Hence, child is the first scientist. I replied. There was thunderous applause. The children enjoyed this different way of thinking. Teachers and parents also smiled at the answer. So you could see that how APJ Abdul Kalam can also give you witty comments. Please allow me to read the next paragraph. During my visit to Assam, I visited Tezpur. I had gone for the convocation ceremony of Tezpur University and also to receive the honorary doctorate conferred on me. After the convocation, I took off to meet school children. It was a big gathering of young people. The theme of my address was indomitable spirit. As soon as I finished my talk, the youngsters mobbed me for autographs. When I finished giving autographs, I faced two interesting questions. One was, why cannot water from the Brahmaputra, which is in flood much of the time, be diverted to Rajasthan or Tamil Nadu, which are starved of water? Only children will have these innovative ideas. Grown-ups tend to see more impossibilities. It was such a powerful question. I was completely beaten. I was sure even the Prime Minister would not have been able to answer it. How to tell the boy rivers are a state subject and our states are fighting for the rights to their waters? That these would bring them prosperity someday, but meanwhile they were flowing wastefully into the sea and causing floods every year. How to answer it? Look at the kind of, you know, bewilderment you find APJ Abdul Kalam when a boy from Tezpur asks, from Tezpur from Assam asks, why cannot the excess of water from Brahmaputra be diverted to drought-ridden country states like Rajasthan and Tamil Nadu? He himself says that nobody, including the Prime Minister, could answer. Now he sees that it is a far-fetched concept where you would find states fighting for reasons that a river is a state right, and he couldn't simply explain why the states fight between each other by not giving water to other states. So he thinks that only students or young minds could have such wonderful innovative ideas, because grown-ups only tend to think about impossibilities that come with these things, so they always go unsolved. And APJ Abdul Kalam acknowledges that he cannot answer it as of now. Let me continue to read the next paragraph. I said, India Vision 2020 demands from the young that they start a great mission of connecting rivers cutting across the states. I personally feel the young have the most powerful minds. They can overcome the negativity of the bureaucracy and some self-centered policies of the state governments to enrich the people of the country. They can even improve coordination between the states and the center, and they surely will. Now, why does APJ Abdul Kalam talk about India Vision 2020? These were questions that were asked at least 10 to 15 years back from today. Now, he says that the students who ask these innovative questions will probably be IAS, IPS and bureaucrats of the present time, or at least 2020. So it is the same youngsters who ask these innovative questions will become or get into the top cadres in the government and government policies, and you know, people who make these policies. So that is one of the reasons he says that this coordination can definitely improve by the students who ask these questions, and only they have this willpower. So he ends the paragraph saying that they surely will. Let me continue to read the next paragraph. Another student asked me a question for which again I had no ready answer. He said, sir, big leaders in any field don't come and talk to us. We see our Prime Minister often going to Chennai, Lucknow and many places, but he never comes here. We want to talk to him. I was impressed by this urge to communicate with the country's leader. I said, when I reach Delhi, I will tell your dream to the leaders and your dream will come true. I later narrated this to the Prime Minister. He considered the point and said, children don't talk to me anymore. Maybe the security cordon has created a separation. I request our leaders in different fields to interact more with the children of the country for a better understanding of their own purpose in life, as also for helping create a better future for our children. So this is yet another stumping question that APJ Abdul Kalam receives from one of the students, who says that maybe he or she is from a very rural place from India, and he or she feels that leaders do not come and meet as they meet the students in a city or even a town. So just because the child is from a village, he or she does not get the chance to meet the leaders, you know, great leaders of the country. Now the great leaders of any country are an inspiration to young kids. So APJ Abdul Kalam takes this valid reason to Prime Minister himself, and the Prime Minister agrees to the point and then says that maybe the security tier that has been created around him, and you might remember it was Prime Minister Manmohan Singh who was the Prime Minister at this point of time we are talking about. So he even agrees to the point and then says that he should probably continue to meet other children in the future. Now APJ Abdul Kalam makes it a point that it is important for leaders from different fields to meet and interact with the children of the country so that the children have a better understanding of their own purpose in life and then to create better future for other children, you know, children to come, right? Okay, let me continue to read the next paragraph. I have visited Jharkhand a number of times after its formation. Every time I visit it, I am struck by the tremendous resources that wait to be harnessed in the state, which will multiply its wealth manifold. At the Sri Ramakrishna High School, Bokaro, I addressed a gathering of about 3,000 students and saw their creativity on display in an exhibition of their paintings, toys and other items made by them. In my conversation with them, one student asked me, "In Jharkhand, it is green everywhere. We have forests, streams and hills. Why is it that we have a desert in Rajasthan?" The question reminded me of a similar one in Assam. Why cannot the Brahmaputra's waters be taken to Tamil Nadu and Rajasthan? You know, 20 years ago, you would not have seen much cultivation in Rajasthan. But once the Indira Gandhi Canal was constructed, agriculture became possible in many places. But once it is possible for man to transform the desert into a fertile land. I repeated what I had told the student in Assam. It has to be one of the greatest missions of India to connect rivers so that water can reach many water-starved states. Visionary action is needed. When you grow up, you will probably be part of reconstructing this nation and giving shape to these thoughts. One child came to me with a serious expression and asked the following question. Now, before that, let me once again give you a recap of what is being discussed here. It is the same question which he remembers from a student from Tejpur asks Abdul Kalam about connecting rivers. Now, the visionary project mentioned here is the nationalization of rivers. Now, nationalization of rivers is a visionary project of India which has not been, which has been planned for a long part of time, but then we have not realized it, we have not come into action yet. But then APJ Abdul Kalam had thoroughly believed that youngsters of India in the future will possibly make this vision into a possible action in the future. Let me continue with the question that another student asks here. "Sir, will your Agni missile cross the ocean and reach America?" I was startled by this thought. For us, no country is our enemy to send Agni there. Particularly, America is our friend. Agni symbolizes our strength. It shows that India has all the capabilities. During my visit to Cuttack, I participated in the birthday celebrations of the late Justice Harihar Mahapatra. I went there at the invitation of Justice Ranganath Mishra. For me, it was a revelation how the independence movement, the first vision for the nation, had created the larger than figure of Justice Harihar Mahapatra. He lived to the age of 92 and established Cuttack Eye Hospital, Utkal University, and above all, organized multi-pronged efforts to remove poverty. My biography in Oriya was released. At the end of the speech, the youngsters crowding around put forth many questions. Now you could see in the last paragraph, you could find that a student is asking, would the country India send missile to America? You could see the sensitive and the careful answer APJ Abdul Kalam gives to this particular student. Now, why in the first place would APJ Abdul Kalam receive such a question from a student? Because we are all aware that Agni is one of the projects which APJ Abdul Kalam himself had developed after serving in DRDO and ISRO. Now, he very carefully explains that we have the capability, but then America is our friend. It is only to show our strength, but then not to make enemies by, you know, sending missiles to not just America, but then any country for that matter. So you could see that how maturely APJ Abdul Kalam and very sensitively he answers this question. he continues to talk about this justice called Harihar Mahabhadra, who has involved himself in very philanthropic activities, which he is very appreciative about. Let me continue with the next paragraph. The first question was, "Sir, tell us which are your favorite books that you loved and which have shaped your mind." I said, "Four books in my life have been very close to my heart. I cherish reading them. The first is Man the Unknown by Dr. Alexis Carrel, a doctor turned philosopher and a Nobel laureate. This book highlights how the mind and body both have to be treated in an ailment, as the two are integrated. You cannot treat one and ignore the other. In particular, children who dream of becoming doctors should read the book. They will learn that the human body is not a mechanical system, it is a very intelligent organism with the most intricate and sensitive feedback system." The second book, one I venerate, is Thiruvalluvar's Thirukkural, which provides an excellent code of life. The third is Light from Many Lamps by Lillian Eichler Watson, which has touched me deeply. It illuminates how we live and has been an invaluable guide to me for 50 years. And the Holy Quran is, of course, a constant companion. You could see that how a voracious reader APJ Abdul Kalam is, and then he explains to the students how he learns different things from different books. I especially love his sharing where he talks about Man the Unknown, where he insists that each and every human being should not only take care of his or her body, but also take care of his or her mind, because mind is an imminent part of the body as well. So there are other books which have shaped him, and especially Thirukkural, which had given him values to look at life, and then Light from Many Lamps, which he feels has touched him very deeply. It has guided him for more than 50 years, and of course his own religious reading, the Holy Quran. Let me continue to read the next paragraph. While I was addressing another gathering of school children in Anand, Gujarat, one smart boy asked a very intelligent question. "Who is our enemy?" I liked the question and put it to the other students, encouraging them to come forward with their views. Then came the answer, "Poverty." What a wise reaction from this young child whom I have mentioned in the dedication. The last question, which I am including here, came from the powerful mind of another child. "Tell me, sir, are Pakistani weapons stronger than Indian ones?" I asked the child why this doubt arose in his mind. "Reports he read in the media led him to think so," he said. Now you could see that it is a similar question a student asked, like a question had been asked about Agni. But then before that, look at how APJ Abdul Kalam feels appreciative about student asking wonderful questions. You know, they have the question, and sometimes they have the answer to the questions they ask themselves. It is not the same student who asks the question and then answers. For example, who is our enemy? And then there are other wise students who says, poverty is our worst enemy. So talking about enemy, APJ Abdul Kalam recalls himself about Pakistan. Now, it is a very sensitive topic which he could talk about, but then look at the way he handles it in the continuing paragraph. Please allow me to read the paragraph, second paragraph in page number 8. "This is a unique characteristic of our country to belittle our capabilities. It may even be genetic." I said, "India can design, develop and produce any type of missile and any type of nuclear weapon. This is a capability only 4 countries in the world have. You remove all the doubts from your mind," I told the child, who gave me a very satisfied look. Now, you could find that APJ Abdul Kalam is making the student feel secure about living in his or her own country. This is important as a leader like APJ Abdul Kalam to feel that they are living in a developed nation, as you could see in the first paragraph. So it is important that APJ Abdul Kalam gives this very sensitive reply to this particular student. Allow me to read the next paragraph. "I have selected only 11 questions here from among the hundreds of questions I have been asked during the course of meeting 40,000 high school students so far. The questions reflect the children's innocence, but most of all, they show how strongly they feel the desire to live in a strong and prosperous nation. I also realize from these sessions how it is important for them to have role models, whether in science, industry, sports, entertainment, or some other field. The question is, can we give our children a role model and how? So you could find in this paragraph that it is only the 11 questions he has compiled from 40,000 high school students whom he had met. But then look at the response he is giving to make this text or put forward this text is that he thinks that it is important for the students or young children to believe that they have to live in a strong and prosperous nation, because all students who ask these 11 questions in this particular text show that desire that they want to live in a strong and prosperous nation. Apart from that, you also find that APJ Abdul Kalam does not relate role models only to a particular field, but then he insists that role models should be from many different fields. But then he is asking a highly rhetorical question that whether India is able to give their children a role model. So he is asking the question, how are we able to, or how we would be able to give our children role models? Let me continue to read the continuing paragraphs. At the dawn of the new millennium came the news that human genome had been decoded. All the 30,000 genes that human beings carry today, we are told, are identical to those of our Stone Age ancestors who lived thousands of years ago. One of the traits that has come down to us from them, along with others that are needed for survival, is the desire for achievement. It is said that nature gave us this instinct because the need to achieve, like the need to reproduce, the need to eat, the need to drink, and the need to breathe, is simply too important to be left to chance. History shows the hunger for achievement is a highly evolved one and undoubtedly the strongest one. We tend to forget it, but it underlines much of our experience. Most important, without it, how would we learn and grow, aspire to greater perfection? So, in these last two paragraphs, you would find that APJ Abdul Kalam very neatly explains to us that, like, we have our basic instincts to breathe, basic instincts to eat, basic instincts to live and survive. Likewise, he gives us the example of people, our ancestors and evolutionary history, and quotes that it has always been our desire for achievement, and it is this achievement which makes us to look for role models. So that is exactly the kind of direct answer APJ Abdul Kalam is giving to us. Let me repeat, it is like the basic necessities we have in our life to eat, to reproduce, to breathe, etc. Survival and the desire for achievement itself is a basic necessity, which is, you know, the need for survival. So we have to achieve in order to survive. And he says that human beings have had this need for survival, which is the desire for achievement, all through the evolutionary history of human beings. So it is necessary, according to him, to aspire for greater perfection than the human beings who have lived before us. So allow me to continue to read the rest of the paragraph. I have seen Dr. Vikram Sarabhai's vision succeeding over 3 decades through sustained and coordinated achievement. At work in that and any other endeavor was the same desire to succeed the limits, and we try and excel. Role models play a guiding role. The power of Vikram Sarabhai was such that others took up his vision and completed it long after he was no more. For you, it could be someone else whom you admire, a sports person, a teacher, a successful entrepreneur. So indirectly, you could find that APJ Abdul Kalam is saying that Vikram Sarabhai could be a role model to many of the children living in India or across the world. And he also indirectly mentions that Vikram Sarabhai is also his own role model, right? So a role model has the necessity to play a guiding role, according to APJ Abdul Kalam. So he says that you could also admire a sportsperson, a teacher, and also a successful entrepreneur, not just scientists. That's exactly his point. He quotes Vikram Sarabhai, but then he says that it could be a sportsperson, it could be a teacher, it could be a successful entrepreneur. Now let me continue to read the following paragraphs. I recently had the chance to meet a legendary personality, a role model herself. Lata Mangeshkar was presiding over a function in remembrance of her father, Master Dinanath Mangeshkar. Lata Mangeshkar is a recipient of the Bharat Ratna, and I felt honored that she had asked me to inaugurate the 450-bed Dinanath Hospital and Research Center in Pune. I visited the hospital just before the inauguration. I found that it would be treating nearly 30% of the patients free. I was touched by the fact that despite her wealth and fame, she had not lost sight of the fact that one needs to do all one can to help relieve the suffering of others. In simple terms, you find that in this particular paragraph, APJ Abdul Kalam explains to us how Lata Mangeshkar, in spite of reaching of the fame of having money in her life, of receiving the Bharat Ratna in her life, and you know, getting many laurels and many awards of being a singer, in spite of all these achievements, she still feels the need to touch other people's life through, for example, building a 450-bed Dinanath Hospital and Research Center in Pune. So APJ Abdul Kalam is appreciative of this particular contribution which Lata Mangeshkar, the singer, makes in trying to help other people in their need and, you know, relieve their suffering. Let me continue to read the rest of the paragraph. Her songs played over the radio have brought pleasure to countless hearts over the decades. During the India-China conflict in 1962, her song Ye Mere Watan Ke Logo moved an entire nation. Few people can claim to have influenced the life of millions in such a delightful way. So you find that apart from Lata Mangeshkar contributing by philanthropic activities, she has also lifted the spirits of many Indians during the Indo-China conflict by singing the song Ye Mere Watan Ke Logo. Please allow me to read the final paragraph in page number 9. Role models can help us focus on what is correct for us as individuals, as groups, and of course as a nation. They can lead us to great success. We seem to have got carried away with the success of a few in the field of information technology. But that is indeed nothing compared to what we can and should achieve. Ancient India was a knowledge society and a leader in many intellectual pursuits, particularly in the fields of mathematics, medicine, and astronomy. A renaissance is imperative for us to once again become a knowledge superpower rather than simply providing cheap labor in areas of high technology. You find that APJ Abdul Kalam in the concluding paragraph is not exactly attacking information technology, the field of information technology, but then at least in his own times, he says that people have been paying a lot of attention to IT professionals only. So you would find that in the last line that, you know, we are not only a country where we provide cheap labor to information technology. As you would know, there are many engineers all over the world who, you know, are as working as IT professionals who work for lesser salaries. And even at the time APJ Abdul Kalam was living, it was the case. So he says that India is not such a country, at least in its ancient history. So he says that using the word renaissance, renaissance means the rebirth. He says that there should be a rebirth to a time where India had been an intellectual superpower. And India has always been a superpower, in at least in ancient India, where we had excelled in the fields of mathematics, medicine, and astronomy. So in short, APJ Abdul Kalam is telling us that we are not a country who could only achieve in the field of information technology, but then we have the capability, we have the knowledge to achieve in all other fields and then become a superpower once again. Thank you for patiently listening to the lecture. I'll meet you in yet another lecture in some other instance. Thank you very much.